Thank you. So what I wanted to do, because I'm speaking quite early, is kind of put lots of the talks that are going to happen later today into some kind of context. So the event's called Digital Journeys, and we really have been on a digital journey, and it's still only just starting. But when I put this together, does anyone know who this guy is? Shout out, no? He's a guy called David Shing, right? He's called Shingy. And he works for a company called AOL, if you remember them. Massive, well, at one point produced 50% of the world's CDs. He's their digital prophet, and he earns a six-figure salary, which is almost enough to make us working in the same industry want to kill ourselves, but not quite. And I'm scared that my talk is a bit like him. So I saw him speak earlier this year, and he basically rambled for 40 minutes about things he think are cool. So if I do, if you've got a kind of buzzword bingo thing going on, call me out, because I want to be told. So you can tweet me that I'm being a bit of a twat, okay? Because I do want to know. But I hope that it doesn't get too much like that. So the New York Times followed this guy around to do an editorial feature on him. And when he went into the AOL office, this is just to give you an idea of the kind of guy he is. I actually kind of feel sorry for him. But he went up to the CMO of AOL and presented a piece of paper and said, I just had a brain fart on the plane here. What do you think of this? It's a bear with zebra pants and a binary ones and zeros t-shirt. Now, all of our cynical UK marketers might go, oh, God, this is stupid. But this is the response of the CMO. Love it, love it, love it. I'm thinking of the bears more as a metaphor. 1,000%. Dead serious. Like, this is the world that we live in, and there is real meaningful stuff in it, but we just have to avoid the crap. So please do call me out if I end up like that. So, digital journey. I've kind of identified four real trends that I think put lots of the other talks today in context and are things that have been happening for many years, but are things that will continue to happen. And the point of the talk really is that standing still and doing stuff and doing best practice isn't actually enough. And you do have to innovate, and you do have to keep up with the trends happening in digital just to stay ahead, just to stay up to speed. So this picture, it isn't actually that weird a scene. I think you could quite happily see something like this pretty much every day. When I showed my mum, she was like, isn't it sad that people don't really talk to each other anymore and we're all lost in our phones? But of course we are. We're communicating more than ever. In like one tweet, not mine, someone sort of influential, can speak to thousands and thousands of people in a second from their phone. People in the 18th century wouldn't speak or see thousands of people in their entire lifetime. So actually the proliferation of devices and mobile and technology is actually meaning that we're more communicative and more connected than ever before. And of course, this is the creepiest family picture of all time. But this is what your families are going to be like in 10 years. You do know that. Just get ready for it. And you won't be walking through Brighton seeing people go like this, you know, not talking to each other, but ain't looking at their phone. You'll be seeing people sort of looking off into the middle distance, rambling and muttering to themselves because they're talking to people online. So nothing will change in Brighton, but it might change elsewhere. This is what the web was like in 1995, right? It's kind of amazing to think this. And I was speaking to someone at Jellyfish, and I'm sorry, I don't remember who it was, but they started a magazine in the mid-90s. And in order to get people to come to their website, they sent an email to Yahoo to say, can you please list it on your homepage? And they did. I mean, imagine that. The SEO industry is just how polite an email can you write to Google to get them to rank high. And the only way of tracking this stuff was, do you remember like the little Simpsons numbers in the corner, how many people have been to this site? And that was pretty much the only analytics and information you had. There was no connected points. I wasn't a single, I was one bit of information visiting that page at school. Whereas now, you go onto your Google account and you see an almost creepy amount of information. I actually love Google, don't worry. And I think that it's nice that they can turn it off. But the idea that it knows how many searches I've done and also knows the sites that I'm clicking to as a result is incredible. The fact that it knows whether I'm on my device, on my computer, or even on my Xbox, it knows what I'm searching for as a unified data set. Luckily, they're all suitable for work, so I had to do some Photoshopping. But it's fine for the event. And it knows which days I search things for. But I think this is really powerful, and the idea that we are connected experiences, you know, technically human. We exist as an entity on digital rather than a single set of data points. So I don't know if you remember this guy. Actually, the slide doesn't really relate to what I'm talking about that much, but I sort of think of him as one of the first apps. And if you remember that very powerful Apple marketing campaign, which was, there's an app for that. At the time, it was like, cool, there's an app for everything. But actually, that sounds kind of crap now. It sounds like, yeah, obviously there's an app for everything, but what there is now are apps for everything. It sounds like an anachronism. But what I mean by apps for everything is that you don't say, go on the App Store and download it now, and that's where it exists, and that's the only place it is. When iPlayer do an update, they have to test it on over 1,000 devices. And if you think about how, when I turn my Xbox on, I expect to go to Netflix within about 5 seconds and start from the midpoint of the episode that I was watching earlier in the day on my laptop. That's how connected services and the internet is making things happen. This one exemplifies it most. You ruined this bit, so basically, when you order an Uber now, you don't even think twice about all the other services that it's reliant on and all the other profiles and accounts that you have. So when you order an Uber, obviously it uses Google Maps, and it can build their own Maps product. Obviously you can decide which route you want it to go, and you can play music in the car using Spotify. This is really indicative of how the edges of apps and services are becoming more blurred. These just exist on millions of devices and millions of services and inside each other, and drawing the boundaries is ever more difficult. Does anyone know what this is? Yeah? Yeah? Clash of Clans, right? I think. I Google imaged it, so it might not be. I've never played it. But this, again, the instant conclusion might be to say, oh, isn't it sad that people are glued to their phones, not talking to each other? But of course, this is one of the most connected things you can do. This relies on sharing. It relies on engaging with other users and posting to Facebook and spamming your friends. But it really is actually quite a social experience. And this isn't to be ignored. This has generated more revenue than every Hollywood film ever. And if you think Hollywood films are a one-way medium, you just look at the screen. This is a much more connected experience and having a bigger impact upon society. So that's it on connectedness. I wanted to get across the idea that it's not just devices that are increasingly connected, but our online profiles and personas are connected in ways that we never really thought would happen. And Google are driving lots of that. The idea that you exist across multiple activities, places, and behaviors. The manifestation of this is data, an increasingly massive, massive mountain of data. And it can be overwhelming to marketers to know exactly what the hell to do with it. But of course, if you think about when Sega released Sonic, I think that was my first game, Sega had no idea. They might know how many units they sold, but they have no idea if I'm playing it, how long I'm playing it for, who I am. Now, someone like Clash of Clans, which I think is Supercell, can quite happily understand that 5% of their customers generate 95% of their revenue. That's quite an interesting fact. They know how long they play it for. They even know what they're doing when they're not playing it. This level of data actually makes businesses far more efficient and able to do things that businesses weren't able to do just a decade ago. But it also has the power to actually make more profound impacts than a profound impact than simply the games we play. So this is data from Brandwatch. I didn't actually say who I work for. So Brandwatch are based in the same building as Jellyfish, and we're close partners. And we are a social intelligence tool, meaning we listen to data and conversations that are happening online and analyze them. And this is people talking about HIV. And when you start to inspect the data, when you listen to people who have HIV, what matters most to them when they're selecting which treatment to go for, it's actually not the common sense that people want to live as long as possible. That was always the common sense and the idea behind pharmaceutical development. And once you listen to what matters to these people, it's actually not wanting to pass it on to loved ones. I mean, how powerful a message is that, that actually pharmaceutical companies have got it wrong and focusing on drugs that are going to change the world in ways that matter most to people? And that's because of the connectedness and exposure of data. This is also from Brandwatch. This is ASOS, one of the kind of tech success stories in the UK, clothing brand. And they wanted to understand their customers as widely sort of connected people. So rather than listening to what people were saying about ASOS, they wanted to know what ASOS's biggest fans were doing when they weren't talking about ASOS. So as a kind of cross-internet experience. And they found that UK ASOS fans don't actually do anything till about 11 o'clock in the morning because they're students, right? And and in the US, they get up much earlier and much more active. And ASOS had no idea that they had this completely different demographic in each market. And now the way they message to customers and the time they message to customers is completely different. This is again, sort of low-res Google image for the word retargeting. But things like retargeting are only possible because of this kind of proliferation of connectedness and programmatic, which is going to come up later today. This is the kind of result and action that you can do as a result of these changes. So this is me thinking about, okay, well, what's next in data? What new forms of data are we going to have at our fingertips in the next few years? So something we're messing about with at Brandwatch at the moment, we don't have it in the platform or anything, but is this doesn't mention Porsche anywhere in the Instagram post. But what if we could teach machines to be like humans and know what a Porsche looks like? I mean, that would be incredible. That would open up a whole raft of new things that Google could show off about the next digital journeys. Yeah, Google already done it, right? So this is my favorite tech release of the year. This is, you can search a word. I don't know if anyone's used it, so sorry if you already know. But it's, you can search a word, and every picture I've ever taken of a car, if I search the car, it will show me. I mean, it's kind of magical levels of technology. And it won't just show me pictures of cars. It shows me pictures of my girlfriend sitting in a car. How does it know? And obviously, it's got some kind of rough edges. They've had some problems recently. But generally, this is the seed of something quite amazing, I think. And actually, it reminds me of this Arthur C. Clarke quote, which is, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. And if we haven't reached that point already, then we are just about to. This slide is supposed to represent conventional wisdom. So the idea that people buy more ice creams when it's sunny and hot. Now, this kind of thinking has informed media spend, has informed messaging, has informed shop locations, and basically everything ice cream brands do for about 100 years now. We work with one particularly massive ice cream brand who won't let me tell you what they're called, but you may be able to guess. And they've kind of had sales data available for a while. They kind of tried to play around with just weather data and sales data and couldn't really find too much meaning in it. When they started plugging in other data sets, things like people saying they were eating ice cream and uploading pictures of eating ice cream, they actually found it wasn't sunny, hot days. It was relatively warm days that it was raining on like a Sunday, and people turned to this brand of ice cream to eat a tub to sort of, you know, complain that they're not outdoors and why are they so fat and their lives are going terrible on a Sunday night. But generally, this changed how the brand started marketing their product and where they started marketing their product and when. And that's the powerful thing about connected data sources. But of course, correlation isn't always causation. I don't believe the amount of mozzarella being eaten has any impact upon the number of engineering doctorates awarded, but it might. So that's more a word of caution. But it's sad that sometimes correlation isn't causation, because you get data sets like this, which is the number of people who drowned by falling into a pool tightly correlate with Nicolas Cage appearing in films, which is all the evidence I think we need to get Nick Cage to stop appearing in films. So to wrap up that second section, or first section really, is connectivity. So there are more devices than ever, and they're connected in more ways than ever. The Internet of Things and all that kind of buzzwords, I said I'd keep it to a minimum, but more things are online, which means things are connected in different ways. Microsoft, Yahoo, Google, Apple, your profile exists in more than one place, more than one device, more than one app. And data, of course. Every single day there is more and more data from more different sources. There's a velocity of data, so the speed of it starting to matter more, the variety, images, videos, text, and of course the volume. This is another kind of manifestation of all of these changes, so transparency. I think this is probably the biggest thing that has affected brands. So when you go out to a restaurant, just like the Google video showed you, you look up reviews now, especially if you're in a city you've never been to before. If your restaurant has too many crappy reviews, no one will ever go there again. And this is democratizing society, it's democratizing business a bit. So for example, when you go on holiday to Turkey, I don't know any of the hotels in Turkey. Am I going to trust the brochures, the homepages of these websites, what they claim to offer, or Thomas Cook? No, I'm going to trust the people that have been there and written about what it was like. And this is turning the whole thing on its head. This is meaning that you can't just marketing your way to success. You have to be really clever. And the reason this is good is because the businesses that do a good job of treating customers right float to the top, and the ones that focus more on the marketing and the masking of the crap stuff actually sinks to the bottom. So us as consumers are getting a better quality service, and actually it means that brands have to focus on treating their customers right, or they'll lose out. Same goes for sites like Money Saving Expert. So people don't call up Eon and EDF and Empower to say, what's the best offer? They go and talk to their peers. They use the power of transparency in the internet to find out what they should do if they're overcharged, what the best deal is for their particular area. And actually, one of our energy clients uses this as an owned channel. So just like Twitter or Facebook page, they create an account for their community managers and customer service reps to actually engage with people asking questions and seeking advice in the place that they actually go to in the first place. And I think that kind of level of transparency is really interesting. This is a disaster in a way. Endorsements, I don't endorse endorsements in any way, especially because I've been endorsed for vegetables, flags, and arguments. You didn't used to be able to accept or reject them, they just went onto your profile. But there's a seed in this, there's something in this. The idea that your peers and the people you work with and the people that you know have something to say about you. What you say about yourself is less relevant than what other people say about you. And actually, when I logged in to take the screenshot, someone had endorsed me, someone I lived with 5 years ago. Vinyl banners, umbrellas, digging, and rope rescue. So there's my backup career if this talk goes as badly as I fear it will. It's the same for us. So enterprise software can cost tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of pounds to companies. Now, rather than listen to Forrester or Gartner or the analyst firms, that kind of thing, or listen to what we write on our homepage, how amazing is it that you can actually listen to what other users of this software have to say about it? So we pay Jellyfish enough money, they'll write a really nice thing about us. No, I'm joking. But the idea that customers actually have a voice louder than us, I think is a really meaningful and positive change. Does anyone know what this is? It's big in the US, it seems to be getting bigger. Glassdoor, exactly. It's bigger in the UK now. This is the same thing for employers and employees. So the idea that you say how much you earn, you say whether you like the CEO, you say whether you think the sushi portions that are free on Wednesdays are big enough. And this is actually informing how people choose employers. So you can't get away with the glossy brochure, just like hotels and restaurants. And making sure that your staff are happy is now another imperative that businesses have to focus on in order to attract the best talent. So transparency is shaking it up. You can't hide anymore. You can't spend your way to success. You have to be clever, honest, open, and helpful. What people say about you is more important than what you say about yourself. The deepest pockets no longer win, and it's kind of having a democratizing effect upon data. So I don't think you can ignore this if you're a brand. The last thing is place. So again, same Google account. I didn't ask it to, but it showed me my walk to work. It's not very far. And actually, you can see me taking very mildly different routes to break up the humdrum monotony of my boring life, just to change things up. But this is cool. I mean, the idea that it knows where I live, knows where I work, and imagine serving me ads when it knows I'm going to the gym, for example, which is never. But if I did, or if I'm going to KFC, and serving me ads based on where I am, or serving me messages, not ads, nice things, is something that is now available to marketers. So it's almost like the physical is becoming an aspect in what was historically just digital. This is a trip I knew I went away. That was all that slide is. Ooh, this one really shows the potential of geotagging and location and physical place playing a role in the digital now. So if you can't read it, it says, please be careful when sharing photos on social media. They can lead poachers to our rhino. Turn off geotag function and do not disclose where the photo was taken. So the idea that a crash of rhinos, never get to say that, but a crash of rhinos can be located through people's social media posts. And these are like poor sub-Saharan poachers that are desperate for money. They're doing more sophisticated things with location data than probably some of the brands in the room. You know, do you want to be shown up by those guys? And the potential for good is even greater than the potential for bad on this stuff. So really do consider it, and I think lots of the talks today you'll hear more info on that. This is another feature in Brandwatch. This is what people are saying about stuff, but put in places where they're saying it. So traditionally we could provide data that says, it knows I'm based in Brighton, but when I'm in Manchester, did it know that I was in Manchester? And now we kind of do know that stuff. This space is only just opening up. Who knows where it will go? But some of the stories so far I think are pretty cool. So Peroni listened to what people in Brighton thought of their brand. It's kind of a premium, nice lager here. In London, they think it's just like a rubbish one. They've got all these lovely breweries and ales. So the way that they marketed their billboard campaigns in London was very different to how they did it in Brighton. And that's purely as a result of understanding local tastes. Another one we work with, Argos, and they map their physical stores to where people are talking about Argos. And that allowed them to discover that people in the north, for example, wanted a more friendly experience. So they changed their hiring processes in the north to make sure that friendliness and chattiness was the first thing they looked for in new hires. In other parts of the country, they found that people were annoyed that there wasn't enough seats while they were waiting for their, you know, their hi-fi or whatever. And in London, people just wanted to get in and out as quickly as they possibly could. And that meant that they changed their staffing processes in London. So I think the fact that you can change your experience, change your product offering as a result of the real world is another really positive and powerful change. So location is playing an increasingly significant role in digital. It's not just who we are, what we do, where we go, what we say, it's also where we are. And physical, as I said, is playing a role in digital. So for brands, this is the completely wrong approach. I think some brands hear people like me or whatever, people better than me, say all these things that are changing and they have to react and they go, right, let's do a social campaign. And that's just completely the wrong reaction. The amount of changes and advantages and opportunities for brands are so long that you could have 1,000 of these events and still not cover them all. But the idea is that it's actually about being more intelligent. So knowing what to do about these changes is difficult, and I think you'll hear lots of examples of how to adapt and adjust today. But connected data, transparency in place are all shaking up what it means to be a marketer. Data is a commodity that everyone wants, so Gartner did some research recently and found that 13 departments now want social data in their operations. And gathering that right data and putting it in the places that matter is super important. So is anyone familiar with this? It's a model that Altimeter put together. I actually changed it because I prefer my version of it. But tell me off afterwards if you think I'm wrong. But this is, you can kind of plot digital sophistication against this journey. So, you know, basic brands are here. You might get a few pioneers. Maybe people in the audience associate themselves with that, where they say, I get this stuff. I think we should be doing this stuff. But it's kind of hard to convince the organization to come along with you. So you get these little internal champions. Eventually, they might be given some technology, some budget, some people, and they can start pushing out programs. The difficulty is it's still this little silo that no one's really paying much attention to. If you're good, you might end up in a coordinated model, which is where you have a kind of hub and spoke, where you have a center of excellence, a bunch of guys and girls or women that really get this stuff, and then they can distribute insights and processes and best practices and reports to the teams that need it. So if you think about how a customer service, product development, sales, marketing, they all want this stuff, but they don't necessarily have the skills or knowledge yet. Eventually, you might get localized centers of excellence in each one of those teams, one in customer service, one in marketing. And right at the end, no one's there yet. We might not be there for another 10 years. But this is where everybody in the organization, even, you know, 10,000 people, are all digitally savvy, get it, are empowered to be able to use it in their roles. Now, this might sound like one of those kind of, you know, buzzwordy kind of models that don't actually make any sense in the real world. But if you can actually track telephone technology against this model. So in the 40s, brands and businesses didn't use phones for the public. It was kind of seemed like this thing, why would you want to allow them to call us? That sounds awful, we can't control the message. But you did get some people saying, hey, by the way, out there, people are calling each other up now. They're not sending telegrams and letters, they're actually calling each other up. We should do something about this. Eventually, they might set up a call center. After that, they might set up a way of, you know, documentation. This is what you do on the phone. And by the end, everyone in the business, from the CEO to the right at the bottom, they're all using the phone as if it was just an everyday part of their job, which of course it is. And we will get there with digital. How do you get across that change? How do you catalyze and accelerate that shift to becoming a holistic organization? Well, I think the answer lies in something to do with putting it in the real world. So that wall at the back is a great example. But taking it out of emails, out of PDFs, out of logins, and actually showing this stuff to as many people as you possibly can. So we work with people like British Airways. Jellyfish has got one through there, it's really cool. But putting this data up in places that people can see it. So Marks and Spencer's and IKEA and British Airways do this stuff. So British Airways have this in their headquarters, in their lobby. And imagine walking past this every single day, whether you're the CEO or a baggage handler, and seeing what people have to say about your brand online. Look how long the only reason I don't fly with BA is because the baggage takes too long. Think about how all of these people in the organization would slightly change the way they do their jobs every day if they had to listen to what customers say. And I think this kind of bringing it into the physical world will play a huge role in helping brands get closer to where they want to be or where they should be. So just to wrap up, we have connected, digital is more connected in ways than it never used to be before, with the proliferation of devices, the convergence of activity and services and apps. Data is generated on a scale like never before as a result. Transparency has become the name of the game in the internet. It's a democratic place. You can't control it as a brand. You can't control it as a government. And as a result, you might have to change the way you conduct your business. And of course, physical. It's playing a bigger role and will only get bigger, especially as people have more devices and geotagging becomes a bigger thing. And also the real world. If you put data in the real world, people are much more likely to look at it. So hopefully I didn't stray into this territory. I thought about getting a t-shirt made up and then I thought, no, that really will cement the deal and I'll never get invited back. But that was me, and hopefully that provides some context to the rest of the talks you'll see today. Now you know. Thank you.